I'm Darren, and I'm one of the pastors here at Focus. And I just want to say it is so good to see every single one of you. I love Sundays. It is by far my favorite day of the week. There is no doubt about it. I love spending time with my church family. Love seeing all of your faces. And I love seeing all of the faces that I'm seeing for the very first time. All of our guests that are here. Focus, can we please give a huge welcome to all of our guests that are here? Love you guys so much. We would love to be able to connect with you. So if you could make your way to the Guest Central tent afterwards, we'd love to be able to connect with you. Just say thank you so much for you being here. We got a gift for you. Just our way again of just saying thank you. We just love the fact that you're here. We would love to have you part of what God is doing in our church in a big way. There is no doubt about that. Well, today we are in week three of a four-week series. So we're going to be wrapping this thing up next week. Today we're in week three of a four-week series called Reclaimed. Somebody say reclaimed up in here. Reclaimed. We're in a series called Reclaimed, and what we're doing is we're learning how to reclaim what's something that has been regulated, something that the culture has said is not that big of a deal. We've neglected this thing in a big way, and what we're reclaiming is simply the table. We're reclaiming the dining room table. Like, what's the big deal about that, right? What's the big deal about the dining room table? And what we know is this, is that in our culture today, for many of us, the dining room table is just simply a piece of furniture in a room that we never use, right? Anybody got one of those? You're like, I don't even know why I have that extra space there. We're never even going to use it. Like, it's just, except for Thanksgiving. Come on, somebody, right? Like, that's when you get the tablecloth out and like, I've never even seen that tablecloth. Where did we get that? We've had it for 20 years. We just never use it. And the reason why is because in culture that we live in today, we get so preoccupied and so busy, don't we? We are so preoccupied, we are so busy, and the idea that we are busy, well, that's important. We should be busy because what we are doing is we're focusing on taking care of our family, taking care of ourselves, right? And what happens is that what we've done is we've bought into the fact that how we supply and how we provide for our family is just providing and supplying their physical needs. Just providing for them financially. And what we've done is we've forgot about the emotional, mental, and spiritual health of the people that are around us. And that's why we need to reclaim the table. Again, why is that such a big deal? Well, what we are finding out in a big, huge study that was done in 2018, and the results were published in February of 2019 of just this year, is that we are facing an epidemic in our country. Western culture is facing an epidemic, and that epidemic is the epidemic of loneliness. 50% of our culture feels completely alone. That's an epidemic. So what we're doing is we're getting to a practical place. It's so simple and so practical for us to fight this epidemic of loneliness. It is so simple and it is so effective. Here's what we're doing. We're simply reclaiming the table, right? We're going to find a space where we can connect with each other. We're going to provide time where we don't feel alone. How many of y'all know that it is? It's the holiday season, right? Anybody got big Thanksgiving plans? Anyway, right? Like anybody planning on watching some football on Thursday? Anybody in here, right? Anybody planning on having the football game on in the background as you're having some conversations with people? Anybody like that, right? Anybody having people over to their house this week, right? Like on Thursday, it's going to be anybody planning on eating on Thursday? Come on, somebody. Finally, we're alive. Now we're talking. Let's do this thing. We love food. I don't know about you, but I love me some food. I love Thanksgiving dinner. I love turkey. I love what turkey does to me that I can take a nap afterwards. Come on, right? Because I don't need to. Do I really care if the Cowboys win or lose? I love it so much. Just let me fall asleep during that game. That's not a big deal, right? Like, just go ahead and eat that turkey. I want to be able to have some. Here's a question. Here's what I want to know. Anybody mashed potato fans? How many mashed potato fans? All right, now how many of y'all stuffing?
There you go.
Okay, like that was pretty close. I think more mashed potato fans. Some of you were like, can I put both? I'm putting both of them up, right? Man, I love that. Some green bean casserole. Come on, somebody. Like, put some corn as the like corn on the cob and just butter all over it. And then just pour gravy over the entire plate. Come on, right? Anybody getting ready for Thanksgiving? That's what I'm talking about. Man, we love to eat in our culture. So why don't we go ahead and reclaim the table of what it's supposed to be for? Because what happens in those moments, like Thanksgiving, like, let me tell you something. Hardly anybody's eating alone on Thanksgiving. You're going to find a place to be able to eat on Thanksgiving, right? Why would we do this throughout the rest of the, you realize we eat seven meals. Most of us eat seven meals a week, 21 meals that we have. And how many of us are using that time to actually connect with somebody? Instead, we're eating alone and we're missing out on opportunities where we can connect. And so how do we fight this issue of loneliness? Let's reclaim the table and use it for what it's for. That's what we're talking about during this. Now, I don't know about you, but like Thanksgiving, when I think about feasting, when I think about food and just like indulging in it, like Thanksgiving is the first one that comes to my mind, right? Like that. But there's a whole lot of other times where, man, we gather for some food, don't we? Come on, right? Like, we got like Thanksgiving, but then, hey, Christmas is right around the corner, right? Who in here makes Christmas cookies? Anybody make Christmas cookies? Can you just send me some? I just want to know who I was going to hit up afterwards. That's all I really wanted to know right there. I love that stuff so much. Like, and man, like, I like Thanksgiving because I'm a turkey guy, but my wife she's ham. She wants a holiday ham. Anybody holiday ham? Man, that's what I'm talking about. I'm getting ready for, I love Thanksgiving because of pumpkin pie. Come on. How many of y'all, any pumpkin pie fans? How about pecan pie? Right? Right, there you go. How many of you are like, no, can I just have some apple or strawberry or rhubarb? Right? Like, some of y'all know what I'm talking about. Like, man, I'm ready for Thursday to be here. Come on now. We gather for some food. Like, the first thing that comes to my mind for holidays is Thanksgiving when it comes to food. The second one that comes to my mind, though, is a holiday called Super Bowl Sunday. There's a lot of food on Super Bowl Sunday, isn't there? Right? Like, that's another one. Like, if you're around a bunch of people, you can barely even watch the game, but you can always get to the food. There's always, like, we gather for some food around here. And here's what I want to do today. What I want to do today is I want to be able to look at all of these times that we gather around for food, and we can use them in a specific way. Because I believe that we waste those opportunities, and so we want to use them in a specific way when it comes to all of these feasts that we have. Let's use them. And what we've done is even prior to this, the first week we said, okay, we want to make a commitment. We need to make a commitment to reclaim the table. So let's go ahead and make these commitments, these challenges that I've given you. And those three commitments that we made were this, that we're going to eat at least three meals together per week. As a family unit, or if you're single, that you can eat at least three meals together per week with somebody who's significant, that's pouring into your life, right? Like, we want to make that commitment. Another commitment that we said, we're going to pray before every single meal. Because we want to connect to each other, but we're also going to make time to connect with God as well, right? We're going to use that time, not waste that time. We're going to use that time as discipleship. Now, let me ask you this question. I love seeing all the hands that are going up. You guys are interacting. I love this so much. Let me ask you this question. How many of you have stuck to this challenge? How many of you have been eating at least three meals together? That's what I'm talking about. So some of you, it's easy. For some of you, I can also see it's a challenge. That's why these are challenges. That's why we have to make the commitment to each other, right? Here's what I'm going to let you know. To fight the epidemic of loneliness that you yourself might be facing or that somebody close to you might be facing, nothing's going to change if nothing changes. You're not going to be able to change the feelings that you have unless something changes. It might be a challenge for you to figure out your schedule to make sure that you're eating meals together. Figure it out. That's how you fight it, is that by changing the way that you're living. Everybody with me? How many of you have been taking the challenge to pray before every single meal, right? Man, make it a habit. I'm telling you, make it a habit. Pray before every single meal. How many of you have taken the challenge to use that meal as discipleship? Anybody in here using that? That's a tough one, right? It changes the way that you think about going and preparing for the meal. Don't just prepare the food, prepare your heart as you're sitting down around the table as well. Open up a conversation, open up a dialogue. I'm telling you, it's a powerful, this is simple and it is effective if you do it, but you gotta do it. So let's go ahead and reclaim the table. And that's what we're gonna do today, is we're gonna talk about how Jesus did that. We're gonna see different ways that Jesus went ahead and he used these feasts, he used the times of mealtime, and he went ahead and he reclaimed the table and he fought these issues that we ourselves are facing today. Check out how Jesus did this in Luke chapter 15, verse 1. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered. I love that so much. Here's what I love about that. People muttered about Jesus. And I hope that people mutter about me too. My hope and my prayer is that people will mutter about me. My hope and my prayer is that people will mutter about our church. My hope and my prayer is that people who don't believe in Jesus, that people who believe the exact opposite thing that I believe, that they're going to mutter about me. I hope they're going to mutter about our church as well. I hope they say something like, man, you know, that boy, I'll tell you what, Focus, you go into that place, there's some Jesus freaks up in there. You go in there, they're all excited. And oh, my goodness gracious, right? I hope that there's going to be people that mutter about me and about our church. I hope as you're going around in your community and you say, hey, what church you go to? Oh, I go to Focus. Oh, for real? Like, I heard some stuff about that church. Good, because that means people are muttering about us. They muttered about Jesus. I hope they mutter about us as well. I hope that there's religious people that mutter about us. Come on now. I hope that there are religious people. I hope that there are people who are, like, they go to another church and they're like, hey, what's going on with that Focus church, man? You go up in there. I'll tell you what. Have you seen the way they dress up in there? Goodness gracious. Goodness. You go in there, they're wearing whatever you want. You go in there, they're going to be able to. It's too loud up in that place, right? Oh, my goodness. I've seen people. You've seen the pastor? He's just up there dancing around. What's going on there? I hope people mutter about us. I hope the religious people mutter about us. I hope that non-religious people mutter about us. Why? Because that means that I'm living our life and that our church is following the example of Jesus. Come on, somebody. Because people muttered about Jesus. And you know what the religious people muttered about Jesus? This man welcomes sinners and eats with them. This man welcomes in sinners and eats with them. Can you believe the people that he's hanging out with? You believe the people that go to that church? Come on, somebody. And eats with them. I love the way that it says this in Matthew 11, 19. It says, the Son of Man came eating and drinking. And they say, here is a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Here's what I know, that Jesus is a friend of sinners. Jesus is a friend of sinners. If there's one thing that I hope that people will mutter about Focus, is that we are friends of sinners. Can I get an amen on that? Because that means that we're living like Jesus. That means that we're living our life and we're following the example of Jesus. I hope that people will mutter about us. I hope that people will post something on Facebook. Come on now. Come on. Can you believe that, church? Give me a bad review. That means that we're doing something right. Come on, right? I hope that people will mutter about us. I hope that people will say, I'm not sure about what's going on there, but maybe we should check it out. I hope that you can be in a place where you are a friend of sinners. I hope that you can be in a place where you can reclaim the table and you can use it in a way that you can use it in a way that's going to change somebody's life. During these times that we're eating and we're having all of these amazing feasts and we're having all these times that we get together, that we can use them in a way that we are reaching people. And so what I'm going to do today is I'm going to look at the way that Jesus used that mealtime as a way to be able to reach some people. I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to challenge the way that you're going to think a little bit. I'm going to challenge the way that you might see things. I'm going to challenge the way that hopefully you might behave when it comes to certain situations. And that we can change that, and we can be challenged by the way that Jesus lived his life, the way that he saw things, and that we can follow his example. And so I'm going to give you three challenges today. Again, these are challenges, because I know that they might change how you view things. They might change your mindset. They might change the way that you're living your life. I hope that they do, and then I hope that you begin to follow the example that Jesus has. So this is what we're going to do, is we're going to look at these challenges, and then we're going to see the way that Jesus used them in a powerful way. Challenge number one is this, that I hope that you will eat a meal with anybody. Be willing to change your mindset and have a meal with anybody. What do you mean with anybody? I mean anybody. I mean like anybody who walks across. I mean like somebody. Check out the way that Jesus did this. Let's go back to our passage in 15:1-2. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Sinners. In other words, this way. Jesus ate with people who acted differently than he did. Be willing to have a meal with somebody who acts completely opposite of what you do. Everybody following me on that? We're like, well, I can't associate with that person, right? Like, I can't be around that person. That, I mean, have you seen the way? What if somebody sees me? Good. Then they mutter about you, right? Jesus was willing to be around people who acted completely differently than he did. And I would ask you to do the exact same thing. Now, let me clarify that. Because, see, here's what happens. What has happened in church and Christian culture is that we've turned into isolationists. Well, I'm only going to hang out with my Christian brothers and sisters. Well, because why? Because I'm holy, and they're not holy. And I'm going to hold up a sign that says it, right? Like, we see that happen, but that's not the way that Jesus lived his life. He ate with somebody who acted completely differently than he did. Now, there are moments in our life that we should separate ourselves, absolutely. For example, if there's a temptation or an addiction that you have dealt with in the past, it's something that you're like, man, this is something I found freedom from, but whenever I hang out with this group of people, I just fall right back into it. Don't go hang out with them. That's called wisdom. But isolating yourself from somebody who acts differently just because you don't like them, that's called bigotry. We need to be able to be willing to have a meal with anybody, even if they act completely differently and they live a lifestyle that is completely different from what you are comfortable with. Because all of a sudden, you never know where that conversation can go. You never know what happens when you just sit down around a table and you begin to share a meal and you begin to share a moment with someone. Change your mindset and be willing to have a meal with anybody who acts differently than you do. Be willing to have a meal because Jesus ate with people who they thought differently than he did too. How many of y'all know that nobody else thinks the way that you do, right? Anybody realize that, right? But yet we feel like we need to be able to completely surround ourselves with people that just think I'm only going to be around people that think the exact same political views that I have. I'm only going to be around people that want to think this way. Well, that's part of the reason why we live in such a partisan country today, why it's so separated. Because we've neglected the table and we're not having conversations with anybody. Be willing to have a conversation with somebody who thinks differently than you do. Don't just have a conversation with them. Sit down and have a meal with them. Reclaim the table. Have a meal with anybody. Check this out in Luke chapter 11, 37. When Jesus had finished speaking, a Pharisee invited him to eat with him. Okay, so we saw Jesus eat with a sinner. Now he's having dinner. He's having a meal with a Pharisee. Well, who's a Pharisee? A Pharisee is a religious leader. a Jewish person, and Jesus was Jewish, so they have the same kind of historical background, the same basic belief system, but he thought differently. See, the Pharisee was raised in a place where he thought that he was saved by making sure that he followed the exact law. All the laws that came before. You know how many laws were in the Torah? 613 of them. And he had to follow every single one of them to be able to get to God. And if he failed in one of them, he's getting smoked. That's it. Done. But yet Jesus said, the greatest commandment is to love the Lord God with your whole heart, your whole soul, and your whole mind. See, the Pharisees thought that it was all about what was happening on the outside, and Jesus began to explain to them, no, it's about the inward. It's about what's going on the inside, and the outward is just an expression of what's happening on the inside. He just had a different thought. He was raised differently. He was taught differently. Be willing to have a conversation. Be willing to have a meal with somebody who thinks differently than you do. Be willing to have a meal with anybody. Be willing to have a meal with somebody who acts differently than you do. Be willing to have a meal with somebody who thinks differently than you do. Be willing to have a meal because Jesus did it. Jesus ate with people who believed differently than he did. Who believed differently than he did. When was the last time that you sat down with somebody who believed the exact opposite thing that you did? They don't believe that there's any God that's around. There's no higher power. They believed in a different religion. When was the last time that you sat down with a Buddhist? When was the last time you sat down with a Muslim? When was the last time you sat down with a Jewish person? Be willing to sit down with somebody, share a meal, share your life with somebody who believes differently than you do. Why? Because Jesus did it. John 4, 7 through 8, it says, when a Samaritan woman... Jesus was Jewish and she was Samaritan, which means that they had different backgrounds. They believed differently. The Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, will you give me a drink? All the other ones that he's sitting down and having a meal, this one is not, he's not at the table, but he's at the place where he's getting a drink. He's at the coffee shop. Come on now. Pastor Frankie, did I stretch that one a little bit, that he's at the coffee shop? That one's all right? Just a little bit. That was a little... exegesis is what that one was. But I had to push it, but he's sitting there sharing a moment with somebody who believes differently than he does. Look at what the Samaritan woman says, continue 19. Sir, I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where you must worship is in Jerusalem. In other words, she believed differently than he did. Be willing to have a conversation. Be willing to sit down and share a meal with somebody who is different from you, who looks different from you, who acts different from you, who thinks differently than you do, that believes differently than you do, because you never know where that meal is going to go. You never know where that conversation is going to go. It might lead you to the second challenge. When you are willing to sit down with somebody, when you're willing to share a meal with anybody, it can lead you to your second challenge. And that second challenge that I have for you today is this, is that the meal can be an invitation. I'm telling you what, a meal is an invitation. In Luke 19, Jesus is getting ready to have this encounter. It's powerful. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through, and a man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was a wee little man. And a wee little man was he. Come on, somebody grew up in church. You know what I'm talking about? We all know that last song if you did grow up in church. He was the chief tax collector and was wealthy. Now, here's the deal. We see a lot about tax collectors at that time. Why are tax collectors always lumped in with sinners and tax collectors? What's the deal with that? Well, so here's the thing with tax collectors at that time. Tax collectors were Jewish people working for the Roman government. In other words, for everybody else that wasn't a tax collector, they were traitors. They were the worst of the worst. And so this is somebody who's the worst of the worst, and he wants to be able to see him. Check this out. Continue on. He wanted to see. Here's what I know. We live in a world that's full of darkness. And people just desperately want to see. They're looking for ways, searching for ways to see. Let me say it this way. They're looking for enlightenment. Well, that makes a little more sense, huh? They're looking for an answer. They want to see. But he could not see. People want to see, but they cannot see. They can't see with their own eyes. They can't find the truth with their own eyes. They need somebody to give them an invitation. John, Jesus says this, I am the light of the world. You can't see when you're in utter darkness. You need light to be able to see. The only way that somebody can see is when they experience Jesus, when they say yes to Jesus, that he becomes the light of the world. Has anybody ever been in one of those, a cave or a dark place, and you're like, I can't even see my hand in front of my own face? And then you literally do that. Anybody like, I can't. I for real can't, you know? That's the way that people are living their life. They think they know the way. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Go back to Luke. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and he said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. Jesus gave an invitation. I love his invitation. I'm going over to your house, right? That might not work for you so well. I love the boldness of that, but if I, you ain't coming over to my house. I'm just letting you know. But you could use boldness to invite somebody to your house. You can have boldness when you're at work to invite somebody to go, hey, you want to get lunch together? Hey, you want to go grab a cup of coffee? Hey, on the way to work, you want to go, let's get breakfast together, man. I'd love to be able to just hear your story, right? It's an invitation. Be bold with an invitation. Why? Because people desperately need to see. They want to see, they need to see, and they cannot see. Well, how can they experience Jesus without an invitation? If Jesus is the light of the world, how are they going to be able to see that light? Romans 10:13 says, everyone, come on, everybody say everyone. Everyone who calls on the name of Jesus will be saved. Come on. Like, I don't know about you, but I called on the name of Jesus and my life was completely changed. Anybody in here calling the name of Jesus and your life completely changed? Come on, right? I once was blind, but now I see. Everybody who calls on his name will be saved. But how can they call on the one that they have not believed in? Well, and how can they believe in the one that they have not heard? How can I experience Jesus without an invitation? A meal can be an invitation. It's an invitation to a meal. It can turn into an invitation in a moment. It could turn into an invitation into your life. And then it can turn into an invitation to your faith. How can they believe? How can they experience Jesus without an invitation? How can they hear without someone preaching to them? Come on now. Go on to the next one. And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? Let me say it this way. Today, I am sending you. Today, I am sending you and giving you the challenge to use the meal as an invitation to just sit around and reclaim the table. Hey, tell me your story. Man, how did you get to Phoenix? Because hardly anybody was born here, right? Why don't you tell me your story? How did you get, what was this like? What was that like? And you just begin to ask questions. And you begin to share your own personal story. And you know what happens when you begin to share your own personal story? You are becoming a witness for Jesus. Because what does a witness do? It just tells of what they've experienced and what they've heard and seen. And that's all you're doing. You don't have to sit down and be like,
Romans 4. I don't even know where Romans is at. Let me go back to the front and see what page is. Okay, go.
Come on, right? That's awkward for everybody. Or you're just sitting down around a table and you're going to say something like, Well, I'll tell you what, we had this moment in church. We just heard this tragedy. And I know, man, I've gone through tragedy, and all of a sudden we were just all praying for this family. It was pretty powerful. And somebody says, well, last tragedy I went through, I was all by myself. I was alone. Hey, why don't you come to church sometime and experience the love of a family? And you're just sharing what you've seen, what you've heard, what you've experienced. But it starts with an invitation to just a meal. Reclaim the table. Be willing to sit down with anyone. Why? Because Jesus did. And when Jesus did that, when Jesus sat down with Zacchaeus, all of a sudden Zacchaeus began to experience something that he'd never experienced before. All of a sudden, his blind eyes were opened at the world that he was missing out on. And in Luke 9, go back to it. Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. I was once lost, but now I am found. I once was blind, but now I see. I know who I am, and I am a child of the Most High. When you just say yes to Jesus, be willing to sit down with anybody and take a challenge. In fact, let me be specific with this. During this season, two big holidays, one of them's on Thursday, and another one's coming up, Christmas Eve. Here's what my challenge is. Invite someone to your celebration. Invite somebody into your house. Invite somebody to come in and experience the joy that might be in that place. And you're just sitting around and you're just having a meal, and you never know where that meal is going to go. Be willing, just as Jesus was, to use that time. Don't waste it. To use that time in a powerful way. It might change somebody's life the way that your life was changed as well. Let's use this time instead of wasting it. Let's reclaim the table. Let's fight loneliness that people are facing, that you might be facing. Reclaim the table and use it as a place where we can connect to each other and connect to God. Thursday could be a powerful day for somebody in a big way. And the last challenge that I give you, it's kind of a tough one. The challenge that I gave you, the two before, were a challenge to reach out to somebody. Because you never know what could happen with somebody else. But the challenge that I'm going to give you today, this last one, is it's more of an individual challenge to change your heart. The challenge to eat with anybody, that's a mindset. Changing your mindset. The challenge to give an invitation is, that's a physical thing, the words that you say to somebody, have boldness in that. And the last one is a challenge to maybe change what's going on inside of your heart during the holiday season. Use the table and the meal and the feast time as a time of remembrance. Church, I'm going to be honest with you, on Thursday, as I was, come on now, y'all right? We need another walking boot.
No, it's a microphone. It wasn't me.
Anyway, sorry, that was an inside joke there. On Thursday, when I had finished the entire message, and Jenny came up to me in the house, and she said, how's the message this week? And usually I'm like, whoo, that thing's fire. Babe, I got saved while I was writing that this week. And this week I said, that's okay. She was like, what do you mean, oh, it's okay? I'm like, it's okay. It's fine. And the reason why I thought that is because I was like, this thing doesn't seem to flow. Like, there's just this challenge that we're going to reach out to people. We're going to invite people. We're going to be able to use these, the holiday season, man. Man, that's what we love to do. We want to be generous with our faith, right? We're a generous church, generous with our finances, generous with our time. We're generous with our faith, encouraging you to be generous with your faith, right? That's what the encouragement is. And then all of a sudden, I felt God was saying, like, but you got to use this time as remembrance too. Pastor Craig Rochelle says this. He says that the holidays are a magnifier. They magnify the emotions that we feel. You're feeling joy, holiday season, you feel even more joy. You feel alone, you feel even more alone. You feel hurt, the holiday season, you feel depressed. Why? We've lost people. We've lost people that we love. And when we go into these seasons, we think about those people that we've lost. We think about traditions that we've done. We think about, well, used to hang this ornament on the tree with this person, and now that person's not here. This person used to make this, and they'd come over, and it's not the same. And it's a magnifier. And it didn't make sense to me. What, God, why are you putting this? Why are you putting this on my heart? On Thursday and then on Saturday, we get a call about a 3-year-old passing away. And we can use this time as remembrance. We can use this time as remembrance. Ushers, you want to be able to come on down? Ushers are passing out elements for communion. At our church, we believe in open communion, which means that it's open for all. There are 2 cups stacked on top of each other. Take both of those cups. There are moments in our life that are magnifiers. And holiday season can be one of those moments. There was a feast that Jesus and the disciples were celebrating together. It was the Feast of Passover, which turned into the Last Supper. The last time that Jesus would have a meal with his disciples before he hung on a cross and died. And as they're sitting down, Luke 22, as they're sitting down having this meal together, Jesus reached out in front of him and he grabbed this bread and he broke it and he began to pass it around. And he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of me." And so they all took and they ate in church. Can you please take the cracker and eat together? Thank you, Jesus, for your body that was broken. For our sins. And then in the same moment, after supper, he took the cup saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you, and by his stripes we are healed." Church, would you please take and drink together? Thank you, Jesus, for your body and your blood in remembrance of you. And I'm sitting there thinking through how the disciples must have been feeling after that moment. Because he said, "Do this in remembrance of me." So that means that they continued on. We still continue on with communion today in remembrance of Jesus. And it's a moment that it's solemn. We're thinking about that moment, the pain that Jesus went through and the sacrifice that he made for us. But there's also a celebration that we have life. He died so that you and I may have life. And I think about how the disciples must have felt after that moment. They knew that Jesus rose from the dead. They saw him. They got to experience it. They saw him ascend to heaven. And they waited until that glorious day that they could be with him in paradise. But when they did this in remembrance of him, he still wasn't there. They had experienced Jesus on a day-to-day basis, sharing meals together, sharing laughs together, sharing pain, sharing life. And then he wasn't there. And during this holiday season, the people that aren't there, we just think that they're not there. And it's horrible. But I also know that those moments can be horribly wonderful too. Because the disciples knew. The disciples had something to look forward to. And I know that the people that I've lost in my life, I know the loved ones that aren't going to be there, that I have something to look forward to. And in the moments of remembrance, that those can be horribly wonderful times too, that they don't have to just be focused upon the fact that they're not there. They don't have to be focused upon the things that I'm missing out, that I can focus upon the times that I did have, that I can focus upon the joy that I got to experience, that I got to focus upon the things that, man, remember when so-and-so did this? Man, that was silly. Remember when so-and-so said this? That was ridiculous. And I can think back and we can have horribly wonderful moments. And that this holiday season, that you get into a place that it might feel horrible and it might feel completely alone, turn it and allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you and have that horrible moment turn into a horribly wonderful moment. That you can surround yourself with the people that are still with you, the people that still love you and care about you, and you can share those stories. You can share those times of celebration, and you can turn your mourning into dancing. You can turn your sorrow into joy, and you can allow those moments to be horribly wonderful. And instead of being alone and instead of feeling loneliness, all of a sudden you can turn it into celebration. Church, would you please stand with me today? Instead of this holiday season being a time of loneliness, let's turn this into a season of celebration. Let's reclaim the table and use it how it's intended to be, as a time of remembrance, as a time of invitation, as a time that we are open up to anybody and everybody. Can we begin to praise God together, church?